This is the nose bearings and gears and the crankshaft. This here is the bearing, which we have to install with the dowel pin farthest to the left. Then this is our timing gear. You notice there's two small dots up here that faces outward toward the pulley. This is a spacer. This is just brass gears, a distributor timing gear. Here's a snap ring that holds it all in place. Here's the oil slinger and woodruff key, and this woodruff key holds the pulley in place.
Always clean all of the crank journals with a Q-tip or a similar tool and then blow them out with compressed air.
I use a little oil from this little oil squirter. Get in there. Just around my fingers here. Notice that the dowel pin hole will always go toward the flywheel. The other two holes here are just for the purpose of oiling. Okay, here we have a timing gear that's being heated up. The only way to press this gear on without damaging it is by using a hot plate or a torch of some kind, or a propane torch, and heating this gear up. You want to use a pair of either leather gloves and maybe a channel locks or a pair of vice grips to pick them up and place them, put them in place. It's got to be a quick, swift motion. If you notice, the crank has a woodruff key that lines up with the slot right here. Here we go. Okay. There it goes. And it says, if the crank gear does not go all the way on, lightly tap it. Okay, on this timing gear, there are two little dots. These mesh with the cam gear, and these dots must always face toward the pulley. You can see them right here. Okay, here's the spacer. It basically falls on. Nice, like so. And next comes the brass timing gear. Again, it's heated up, and we'll have to slip over the woodruff key. Okay, there it goes. The brass timing gear has no particular way to go on. There's no front or backwards on the timing gear for the distributor drive. It just has to lock down on this dowel pin. Okay. Okay, where's that little... There you go, you saw it pop on? Yeah. Okay, now we're going to install the nose bearing. As you can see, the nose bearing has a small half moon here, and also a dowel pin hole. Again, the dowel pin hole is off the center, and the dowel pin hole is closer to the flywheel.
Before installing the nose bearing on the crank, put it in the case and mark it at the case half. This will help you make sure the crank is fully seated when you install it later. This procedure is covered in just a few minutes. This bearing has not been marked, and it should have been.
Like the other bearing, the dowel pin hole is not centered perfectly in the middle of the bearing. All the dowel pin holes will actually be closer to the flywheel, or in this case, to the bottom of the crank. Make sure there's no burrs on it. I will sometimes routinely clean off the edges a little bit. Now, to install this woodruff key, I just have to place it in place like so. Then, using strictly a brass hammer, tap it in place. Okay. It was because of the way the oil slinger is in place, with the bevel hanging over the front of the woodruff key, it's sometimes a little bit difficult to install. So I take a little punch like so. There, it's perfect. Okay, I purposely set these rods in this position to let you know exactly how they're going to be hanging on the crank. If you notice that each of these rods have a throw on them, a little nub, these always have to go up. Okay, all these nut rods are also numbered, and the numbers have to match from top to bottom, and they're also in the same position as the throw. They will also be up. I'm going to go ahead and mark the groove. Okay, the bearings fit right there. This tang here keeps the bearing permanently locked in.
You may want to use Plastigage to check the rod bearing clearances.
Like so. This is going to be the number three journal. We're going to go ahead and put the rod, connecting rod to the numbers, and the throw on the up position. We'll oil up the bearings carefully. You want to click it, and then click it again once. Then go on to the next. Axial play on the rods, back and forth, must be between 4,000 and 16,000. And here, 4,000 easily fits in here, yet 16 is too tight. These 1,600 rods have a small little indentation here that has to be peened over. If you notice, that the rod nuts have a little lip on them, and that's what they're designed to do, is be crimped over. Here I'm using a blunt-faced chisel and lightly tapping it with my brass hammer. Here you can see how the little lip is now peened into the groove.
Don't reuse rod nuts that have been peened over like this. Not all rod nuts have this feature. Use Loctite on all your rod nuts to be safe.
As you can see, we have a rod here that doesn't want to fall all by itself. All rods should turn freely, such as this one and the neighboring rods. But this one right here seems to be a little tight. You can see right now, it's offering quite a bit of resistance. When I push it, it doesn't want to fall by itself under its own weight. There it is a little bit, and as it comes around, it becomes stiff. You can see I have to actually force it around. We've actually taken this rod and tried it on different journals, and to no avail. It always seemed to be tight. So there's something wrong with machine work on this rod, and we don't want to run it that way. More than likely, if we were to run the engine with the rod this tight, we'll either burn up the bearing, burn up the rod, burn up the crank, or all three. So, in this case, we'll probably have to have the rod taken off and re-machined.
Pull it back, your hand off.
It's way too stiff.
And then it stops. Yeah, that's
what I want. But it's also, if you push on it hard or pull on it, you have to really fight it to get it.
You've got to pull on it down to the bottom there.
Right.
But does it fall the other direction? Okay.
There it goes.
Show the other one.
Yeah, show the one that... Yeah.
So.
Okay, go back to this top and come, just let go of it and let it come back. Yeah, there. It almost falls that direction, but not quite.
Right.
There it goes.
There it goes, there it stops.
Okay, and then it gets really tight down near the bottom of the trail.
Right.
What area do you think is tight on here?
I think the heel's tight right here. Okay. And this rod is that rotates freely, we have the proper amount of lateral movement right here, as you can see right here. That means we have axial play from side to side. And this rod right here, that's stiff, we have none whatsoever. So it appears that the machine, what it is not quite machined straight, and the heel of the rod is bent over left to right just a little bit, but enough to interfere with the rotation and the lateral movement of the rod itself.
This is the heel of the crank showing the clearance of the rear main bearing. This crank has been turned to 20 thousandths under, while the bearing is for a crank that is only 10 thousandths under. This is too much free play. In order to help avoid this, try getting your bearings from the same place that does your machine work. Don't rush your engine assembly. Here is the correct rear main bearing for the crank. As you can see, the fit is quite a bit tighter.